So welcome everyone to this last webinar of the year. So today we're going to talk about citizen science, empowerment, inclusiveness, and equality with four main presenters. So to begin with the webinar, I will first do a little bit of an overview of the framework in which these webinars are taking place for everyone to know. So this webinar is organized in the framework of the Smarter Project, which is an European funded project with the main aim to create a virtual institute of a virtual research institute within the ECIU University Consortium. So for now, we have been organizing these webinars to allow the researchers from all the universities to present their research and to get to know each other and find synergies between them, so that they can know actually what is going on in the European universities which are part of the consortium. So, and the next step is a co-creation workshop, as you see here, to be able to elaborate proposals for citizen science pilots that will be funded by the Smarter Project. So I welcome everyone who is interested to come to the webinar in February. So it will be the 3rd of February, and everyone from ECIU University is welcome to share their ideas and to find collaborations among the researchers. And then the next steps are to actually implement these pilot projects. So now we can start with the webinar in itself, and then if you have any questions related to the Smarter Project, we can address them later. Thank you. Yep. So Petra, you can.
Okay.
Start if you want.
Yeah. We're okay. Yeah. So today I'm taking this weird role of co-director of the show with Sofia. So yeah, my name is Petra. I work at the UAV in the different citizen science projects. I'm also part of the ECIU Empowerment, Inclusiveness, and Equity Working Group. And I will present a little side work of mine that's called Citizen Science in Non-Weird Context. I will tell you more about it later. Then we will give the floor to Ivy and Tina. Ivy, I hope I can pronounce your surnames well. Ivy Honkatukia and Tina Ratila. And they will be talking about the all youth studies, working with youth, young people, and this core research and methodology. Then we will give the floor to Daniela Figueiredo, which is working on molecular biology and water quality in this project CITAQUA. And finally, we will have our dear Professor Michael Sjögert, maybe, Jørgensen. I try to put my best Danish accent, but sometimes. And he will present this framework of citizen science and empowerment, inclusiveness, and equity, because he is also part of the working group, and that's how we know each other. So yeah, maybe I will just jump. One thing, write all your questions and comments in the chat. I will be taking some notes, and we will have like a moderated discussion session at the end. So that, yeah, please don't feel shy, write your questions for any of the presenters, because we won't have time after the presentation to have this question and answer, but it will all be like at the end. So even if you have questions that are transversal to several of the topics that we talk, just put them in the chat and I'll try to take care of that. So, well, maybe you want to present myself.
Yeah, so So I just wanted to introduce Petra, who is a postdoctoral researcher here at ECIU UAB, and she has a PhD in environmental sciences and has worked in citizen science projects related to using interdisciplinary approaches. So she has worked in connected projects, for example, and also in the citizen science platform OpenTech. So I can welcome Petra and give the floor to her so that she can present her project.
Thanks. So I will share my slides. So as Sofia has explained, I have been working in several different citizen science projects. What I'm gonna present today, it's a bit different. It's kind of like a meta-analytical thing we started. But I will also say two slides about the OpenTech platform and how it has developed. So I work in LASEC. It's a laboratory for social ecological systems in the Institute of Ciencia y Tecnología Ambientales. That's an Institute of Science and Technology Studies in the UAB. And right now, all my work is based on is under the umbrella of the LICHI frame of the LICHI project, which is an ERC-funded project that stands for Local Indicators of Climate Change Impacts. So it's integrating local knowledge from indigenous peoples and local communities into climate change research. So this presentation is a bit about the idea of citizen science in non-weird contexts, and to understand that, I want everyone to close their eyes and imagine a citizen science project. Okay, many of you work with diverse communities, but some might not. So please imagine, close your eyes, imagine a citizen science project and imagine who is participating, what are they doing, and where are they based, right? And you probably have thought about something like this, right? So people in a context where there is some nature, but there's also internet connectivity. Normally white people from middle class, probably, and collecting environmental or geophysical data, right? The thing is that those contexts are weird contexts in the sense that they are based on Western countries, engaged with educated participants, are set in industrialized or at least very urban or industrialized settings where there is infrastructure, no, like electricity and data coverage. Normally participants are middle income or high income, they work with democratic institutions and governments that are transparent and reliable. But the problem here is these weird contexts are very biased. And when we study citizen science and like the challenges, the impacts, the solutions and that citizen science can bring, if we only focus on these weird contexts, we're introducing bias because more than 3 billion people are missing from the picture, right? So what we did, we got together in a conference in the last virtual conference with a bunch of projects, 15 projects, that were working in this non-weird context, so non-Western or working with non-educated participants or in remote and rural areas in developing countries. And we did this meta-analysis and reflexive work all together, filling in some surveys, doing some workshops thinking about challenges that we faced, the strategies we took to overcome those challenges and the impact of our work. And so this work we will submit to the journal Citizen Science Theory and Practice. So hopefully next year it will come up. But now I'm going to talk a bit about the specific project that I was leading in collaboration with other people, Ramin Soleil Manifard, which is our developer, and Adrian Tofighi, which is the project leader. So I was kind of like helping cooperating there, so secondary role. And so what we did was to try to transform this citizen science platform, OpenTech, that was a bit like contributory or like people were contributing data, but the idea was from us and the design and the and everything was we that were doing it, into more like an observation network, and that would be led and or co-designed by indigenous peoples and local communities. So basically the idea is to go from this framework, no, where there is like the reality or the data that you want to gather, no, in this case our case was climate change impacts that are perceived by indigenous people, farmers, students, but really any citizen in the world, that interact with a platform that's open tech in this case, and that we as scientists can have designed, but we also get the data in the end, right? I mean, people can download the data of the project and each other's data, but it's really like the scientists are in the center, right? And the other people are in the periphery. And it's a really nice project as a citizen science project, I think, because you have a lot of options, you can see a lot of data. I suggest you go to opentech.eu. But the point was that we wanted to go beyond that, and we wanted to know what would communities want to collect and what data they would need or they would be interested in, instead of having them use our platform, no? So we engage in these co-design activities in which the community was meeting with the developer, and they would say which priorities were for them and what type of information they wanted. And so it became this Oblo network framework. Oblo stands for Observations Locales. And the idea was, okay, let's build a technology that is flexible enough to kind of have this small shift. So if in the indigenous peoples or local communities don't care about this climate change impact, but more about evacuation routes or about adaptations or about risk, it can be integrated in the platform in some way. And the platform has this flexibility that it can adapt. And also a platform that will be multi-language, because that's super important in our cases, right? So having it in Thai, Vietnamese, having it in different languages that are not like English, Spanish, French, etc. No, so they call on nicer languages. So I don't know, I can just wrap it up with some challenges that we face, and this comes from the collaborative work. So most of, in our case not so much, but in most of the cases that we explored with this non-weird context, one of the main challenges is the security of participants, because they are normally engaging with and collecting data that is sensitive, like for instance monitoring forests or mapping their territories. And so like the actual security of these participants is a key challenge. Of course, the lack of infrastructure and internet and even electricity, because that really determines what technologies you can use. Also issues of data privacy and ownership, because the data is sensitive, and also because the way in which we work, it doesn't really make sense to own the data in an institution, but rather to have it locally stored or shared. And of course, participant motivation, this is a general challenge, no, for all citizen science projects. But imagine, you know, that your livelihoods are threatened or your actual life is threatened. Participating in a project that monitors butterflies maybe doesn't make a lot of sense, or you won't be so engaged. So like some of the ways to overcome these challenges were adopting this human rights approach. So instead of having like a research question in the center, and the data collection as a main tool for answering a research question, there is this human rights approach where you put the rights that are threatened in the center, and so you use the data and you design the tool so that it can help them advocate for those rights. And in this sense, another very, very interesting strategy from all the projects is this co-research culture approach that you will hear more from in the following presentation. But also this idea of co-design. So it's not just like we do the questions together. It's like even like the technologies we use, we need to do together so that they are adapted to the local and fit locally. Other strategies were data sovereignty. I won't talk a lot about this, but this is going to be very important in the future, I think, especially working with indigenous peoples. And paying for participation. That's kind of like the big watermelon of citizen science, right? So we are always thinking about volunteers doing this work. And in our cases, this doesn't work. Like people are from very low income countries, and you actually, if you want to be equitable, you need to pay for participation. And that means accessing non-research funds, because a lot of times the research funds are restricted. And finally, impacts that we actually got together were not so much in terms of scientific output. So we won't discover a new galaxy or a new species with this type of citizen science, right? But we really thought that we had to put in the center the advocacy output. So like gaining rights and local action and empowering these communities through citizen science, and valuing or revaluing these non-Western epistemologies and way of thinking and doing. So that's my presentation, and I would really encourage you, if anyone wants to contact us, because the Oblo technology, like the technology we've used, is open source. It's written in Python and it's really adaptive and multi-language. So any kind of project that wants to use this technology should contact us, and we can talk about how to integrate it. Thanks. So now I am going to give the floor to Tina and Paivi. So they are going to be presenting the old youth studies and how they are applying the core research methodology that I mentioned with young people. Paivi, well, they both work at the Faculty of Social Science in Tampere University in Finland. And Paivi has studied young people's positions in society and agency in relation to diverse questions. So they she has worked with youth societal participation, gender and sexual violence from young people's perspective, etc. Whilst Tina is more focused on the political science because she has a political science background, and collaborating in these all youth projects, she works with the professor Hong Katukia, hope I pronounce it well, and working more on democratic and political theory, so youth participation, civic activism, mostly using qualitative research methods, among others. So, kiitos, Paivi and Tina, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Petra, and thank you, Sofia. Let me get our slides first. And from the beginning, do you see them okay now?
Yes.
Nice. I think our core research processes were partly weird, but they were partly also non-weird. And we can sort of associate with many of the things that you mentioned in your presentation, Petra. And you also nicely introduced us, so we don't need to do that now. All right, so All Youth is a six-year multidisciplinary research project which works out of three universities in Finland. We are funded by the Strategic Research Council, which is a governmental funding instrument administered by the Academy of Finland. In All Youth, we study young people's societal participation in Finland, especially as it relates to sustainability and sustainable well-being. We are interested in how young people aged 16 to 25 or so see their opportunities to influence matters and decision-making that affect their lives, and what they think about their future in the society, in the world, and on the planet. Today, we will present to you briefly how we have applied core research methodology with young people. We will come back to our empirical cases in just a little bit, but let us start by pointing out that we understand core research as kind of falling under the more general methodological umbrella of citizen science. Both share similar basic principles and objectives about democratizing science and making participation in it available for all interested citizens, as well as residents, since not all lay participants are actually citizens in the passport sense of the word. Like in two of our cases, co-researchers were young people with refugee background. However, there are practical differences in carrying out co-research as we have experimented with it in All Youth, at least compared to larger big data type of citizen science projects. Some of the practical features that were specific for our project are referenced to in the right column of the slide. Our co-research projects were actually small, engaging altogether 15 or so young men and women, and all of them were what can be described as vulnerable people, which brought certain challenges to our collaboration, especially in terms of research ethics. We had a few special starting points for our research collaboration with young people when we started, which also reflect our epistemological commitments. And these are mentioned in the left column. Basically, we approached our co-researchers as equal research partners to the extent that was practically possible, because it wasn't always possible. Listening carefully to young people's life experiences and ideas, and planning and carrying out the research process jointly. We made all major decisions concerning the research together with these groups of young people. But next, Päivi will tell you a bit more about our three projects, and I will add in just a few words myself.
Thank you, Tiina, and thank you for inviting us to present our studies here. It is a great pleasure. So I will now continue in presenting some examples of our co-research processes. The first one we have here is a collaborative undertaking between us and an NGO, which was called Refugee Support Finland. They had and they still have a training model for young men with a refugee background who are outside of working life or education. And in this model, a group of approximately 8 to 10 young men engage in 4 months training period. And the aim is to strengthen their capacities and skills to enter education or working life. And this training includes group-based activities and individual guidance. And this Refugee Support Finland has run several of these kinds of groups, and we took part in one of the groups. And in this group, we explored the potential of art methods, and that is theatre and photographing, in promoting young refugee men's social inclusion and well-being. In practice, we, for example, organized sessions in which young people's life stories were first listened to and then acted back to them by playback theatre actors we involved in this project. And then we discussed these stories together. And this collaboration culminated into a public theatre play based on these stories and presented by the actors. And together with the professional counsellors and young men, we evaluated whether these kinds of activities increase their young men's well-being and inclusion in the Finnish society or not. And the second example it comes also from our collaboration with the Refugee Youth Support Finland. And in this undertaking, we ended up forming a research group together with the young men whom we initially encountered in the premises of the NGO's youth center. So from the beginning, we negotiated together the terms of our collaboration. And our research group, we gathered approximately once a month, and we decided together what we wanted to study, how we wanted to study this question, how we wanted to analyze the material, and how we wanted to report the findings. The theme we ended up studying or exploring together was how to get work in Finland. And this was a very crucial question for these young men. And we selected interviews to be the data collection method. And the young refugee men interviewed their peers. And we also decided to interview professionals who are responsible for recruitment and supporting young people's access to work or education. And then we published together with the young men a research blog in our project's website, and it's still there. So, and then Tiina will talk about the third example we have here.
The third example was a collaboration that was established with Occupational and Educational Support Service Workshop in a small city of Ikaalinen, which is located near Tampere, with around 7,000 residents. So it was a very small town. The young participants in this workshop were at that time not in education nor in working life. The workshop organized activities for young people and supported them finding their ways to education or work, or as in many cases, back to education or back to work. We collaborated with the counselors and the young people in the workshop with an aim to propose ways of redesigning the youth services in the city so that they would better take into account young people's perspectives in their operation. And this research theme and the research questions were decided on and designed by the young people themselves.
Okay, then we have our final slide here, and these three examples were just some examples of our various activities and experiments, and we have learned a lot, and now we would like to give some examples of our observations and self-reflections during this route, and what these kind of collaborative research process means, and what is the wider meaning, and how did we succeed? First of all, we would like to emphasize that adopting this kind of a co-research methodology requires a lot of time. It requires patience and ethical sensitivity. And in our case, the collaboration that we had with the institutional partners has helped a lot in this. And it is also important that we were a group of researchers, not just lone researchers, so that we could discuss together, reflect together the difficult points and decisions that we had to make. And we really find this collective discussion very important in these kinds of projects. Second, we found out that taking part in research, as it is voluntary, it often happens that not all the participants stay, but we learned to think that it's okay. And we really appreciate all the different forms of participation that we had, regardless how long they lasted and what was their duration. Third, we found that young people generally value very much that we approached them without the kind of a braced top-down agenda that they are usually approached with. First, we of course encountered wanderings and what we are doing here, our odd gazes from the young people. But later on, we have also received appreciation of our research style and wishes from young people that the collaboration would have been even more intensive as it was. Fourth, and according to our experience, the key element of co-research is interaction. It is constant negotiations, efforts to build trust, communication. It involves emotions, bodily sensations, power relations that need to be actively reflected and thought about when doing this and evaluating the research process. Fifth, we regard important that the self-critical reflections and researcher reflexivity as essential in evaluating the process, what we have done. We should not naively trust that we are able to overcome easily the various power differentials or gain trust from young people. It's hard work and it doesn't always succeed. And these are key elements that need reflection. Sixth, we have learned that not to be too afraid of making mistakes. It is obvious that we made mistakes, but acknowledging that we are humane and make mistakes, we think that it is a possibility for learning, and it's essential. We can learn some essential issues of the nature of co-research as a form of knowledge production. So these were just some reflections, and we will be reflecting this more. We are just editing a book together with Tina that we hope will come out in the next or year after. Reclaim the Future is the working title now. And I think this was our presentation, and the last one was just thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having us in this webinar, and thank you for listening to us. If you have any questions, we will be able to answer them later on, or you can always contact us by email. Thank you.
Kitos. And thanks for being in time, almost. Yeah, but really nice. I will now give the floor to Daniela. Bom dia, Daniela. Daniela works at the University of Aveiro. She has a PhD in biology and has worked mostly on these cyanobacterial blooms. So we're jumping from social science, political science, used to like really tiny, tiny creatures that are really important in water quality, as she will explain. And she really has tried to involve more people in this ecology of cyanobacterial blooms through science communication and environmental education activities, and has some co-directed, coordinated small projects on citizen on science communication with also young children and youth, working on citizen science and water quality. She will present the project CITAQUA, and the floor is yours. Tell us more about this cyanobacterial blooms, please.
Not today, Petra. My research field is on that, but the citizen science projects that I've been working with, it's not exactly on the cyanobacteria. It's from the groundwater, so cyanobacteria don't have a chance of the light to make the photosynthesis. So not today, but hopefully in the future, I hope to bring something on the cyanobacteria. Okay, I think I won't be able to share my screen. I don't know why the Teams doesn't let me. So I will ask or Petra or Sofia to put the slides for me, okay, please. And today I will be talking about environmental issues, but those social questions and challenges that you've been talking about before, they are present also, because even in weird contexts, equitability is not always achieved. So there are also questions about it. So, okay, good morning to you all. I'm Daniela, and I'll talk to you today about a local example of citizen science for the monitoring of groundwater quality through the wells. Okay. Okay, we can go forward. The next slide. Okay, some objectives of the CITAQUA project, some general issues concerned bringing science to society, because citizen science is important, but science communication must come along. Otherwise, it's very difficult to engage people for an environmental issue, for instance. So it was very important in this study also, the participation, even if not active from all of them, to engage different stakeholders. So it was a very important objective. And information that was retrieved from the project was also a decision supporting tool, mainly for the citizens, not as important, as a decision supporting tool for making decisions, political decisions, for instance, but for each citizen that participated, that started to know about the quality of the groundwater. They made behavioral changes by knowing if the water was good or not to use at home, for instance, and many of them had to change that. So it was a very important decision supporting tool for the citizens, okay, mainly for that. Okay, environmental and ecological awareness through participation was very easy to make. So I think it's the best way, as you talked about it before, Petra, for instance. Yeah, it is a subject that is directly connected to the citizens that are working with us. It's very easy to make that connection. So awareness comes with that because there is a personal interest in working also with us. The youth, it was also encouraged to work with science and this kind of things. And in particular, the case was to study spatial and temporal variations in groundwater quality at Tarraja region, a small city, through the monitoring of wells. Okay, we can go forward. And the image is bigger, so maybe it must come to the. Yeah. Okay, the partners involved were the university, where I stand, the National Health Institute, who also helped by making some of the sessions for awareness about water quality, and also laboratory analysis. An important partner was the secondary school, because half of the participants were from there. A teacher had a class that worked on in bringing samples, so taking samples that were spread across the municipality. So it was very nice to work with, because we had already in school, we already had a representative group of samples. The city hall was also involved, also not very actively, but it also participated in the seminars and with the presentation of results. And the citizens, yes. The participation process, participatory process was made with meetings with partners at the first stage, and then short public talks concerning different issues, but mainly the face-to-face meetings in each house with each one of the participants. I mean, we were in the classes in the school also, but we also went to their homes to explain how to do the things and the procedures and how to report them. Okay, the methodology, it was simple, but demanding, we could say, because every 15 days we asked people to collect one sample from their wells and do some measurements. A dedicated kit was given to each participant, each pivot, let's say, because participants were more, but for each well, we defined a pivot citizen scientist that would lead the analysis in each well. So a data sheet, a paper data sheet, was also given to the participants to fill in with already the dates that they should have to collect the samples. Which was also every participant also received a message, a mobile message, remembering them that they should take the water within that day or the next one. So the interval was 2 days. The upload of the data, preferably it would be directly into the application, into the web platform. So we explained how to do it. And as a reward, besides knowing the environmental parameters that people measured and already knew at the present in real time what was the result, microbiological analysis was also provided for free to participants. So they had a global view about the water quality in their wells, okay? The results, they are here, 27 wells, but the question is that these 27 wells had more than 18,000 measurements. So it was through time. The main demanding issue was that it was a temporal project. So it was somehow demanding for the people who participated. Okay, so more than 100 citizens were involved because the families at home were also involved. Many of the students, for instance, had to go to their granddad or grandmother to use the well to take the water. So this, and they had to explain what they were doing. So this was very interesting because there was also a connection with the community. Okay, so if we can see here the pivots, of the citizen scientists, they were mostly the young people from the school, but also people between the 45 and 65 years. So it was also, it was heterogeneous, let's say. And this allowed us to know also some points regarding the equitability issues and how we must design the projects for citizen science. For example, the age web of the uploaders was about the school students. So yes, they were all available to do that. Yet people with 45 to 65 years were also able to put the data. So we have here heterogeneous groups, even within the age sectors. Okay, so we had, the distribution was very representative because we have points in every region of the municipality. Okay, Sophia, please. Okay, we have some data here, some not preliminary because the data is already gathered, but the amount of data deserves a deeper study because it was very interesting. In here, we have only the average values, so it's average values from several samples through the year. So we can see a diversity also from groundwater that is very pristine, let's say, to water that is very vulnerable to contamination, and namely superficial contamination, because when it rains, the water quality reduces drastically. So it's very important to have this kind of information, and it was possible to have it from the temporal perspective of the data taken. Okay, we can go forward. So these data are being crossed now with the aquifer studies and maps to check why in two different points, so together, so nearby, the quality is so different. So this has to do with the underground aquifer characteristics. Okay, nitrates, it's also, yeah. We can go forward. For dissemination, let's say restitution also from the project to the community, we made a public seminar at the end of the period to sample, and it was organized with the Environmental Education Association. So it was it had a broader spectrum, let's say, to achieve more people, and every partners were involved. It was at the secondary school that it was a major partner. We can go forward, and Sophia, please. we also had the presentation of the posters made by the students, so they also analyzed the information. It was very important, that part also. So schools are a very important partner for citizen science projects. It's as I always say, they have several positive points to work with. Okay, Sophia. It was also, the project would be also disseminated through a film because it was a film from the social sciences. So it was interesting to make that connection. And the kids at the school, they had a chance to show what they did with the samples and how they do it. And how they did it. So it was very interesting to make that share of the course. For the students, it was also worth it because it showed that their work and their effort was also acknowledged by others. So it is very important also. It was also selected for a festival film that is also happens in the municipality, but it's international, so it's very interesting. And they also met again. We also met again at the festival. So it was very nice to make that connection and not to forget, because the project ended, but it's important to maintain the connection. So if it would be possible to go back again to the project, I think this connection would be crucial. So it's very important. Okay, Sophia. And instead of conclusions,
you're a bit over time. So if you can do like a wrap up of like these last slides and
it's the last slide.
Ah, okay. Thank you.
Sorry. The last slide. Instead of conclusions, I would like to bring some challenges that are also felt by the other colleagues. This issue of the open data is very interesting. But for instance, in this case, we had the wells located in the houses people. So georeference data, it's very sensitive also here. So how can we manage that? And the co-authorship of the academic outputs. I don't know if you noticed, but I have too many co-authors. So they were also included here because mainly those who made more than two samples. It's very important to also make recognition from there, but we must see how, because in the academic world we are also the researchers are also I don't know how to say it, it's not very good to have more than three authors, for instance, so it's not very encouraging to put all the people that work with in the project. Another issue is the digital accessibility, because the design for all is very interesting, but even so, we have to have alternative approaches in paper, for instance, because older people did not put the data on the web app, so it's very interesting, and we must know approaches to deal with that. And another issue that must be included, it's the European or universal platforms for data inputs. We had also that discussion, but for the co-creation seminar, I will leave that, because everyone has a platform and how are they connected, right? People only put the data on one platform. They won't do it on 100. So this issue must be thought about by the scientists and the researchers. Thank you very much. Sorry for the delay.
Don't worry. It was super interesting, even though it was not about bacteria. So anyone, if you have questions, please write them in the chat. I see there's not a lot of activity and all the presentations are super interesting. I have written like 1,000 questions myself, but I would like to give the voice to everyone that wants to ask something. So go ahead in the chat. We will follow to the next presentation, and then after that presentation, we will open the floor for questions. Okay, thank you. Obrigada, Daniela. Muito obrigada. And so now we're going to hear from our last presenter, which is Michael Sugar. Michael is, he has very different hats, so I'm going to talk about just some of them. So he works at the Center for Design, Innovation and Sustainable Transition. in the Department of Planning at Aalborg University in Copenhagen. His background is on chemical engineering and technology assessment, and he has worked a lot about on environmental design and innovation, and also on societal transitions. So how to put technology to use in use for societal needs, but also assessing different technologies and technology foresight. He has another hat that I know of. He's also very active in the Living Knowledge Network, I think it's called like that. And he also has been working in this science shop, so bringing this different approach of bringing science to with students and society and co-design of technologies. And finally, he is also a chair at the European Citizen Science Association Working Group on Empowerment, Inclusiveness, and Equity. And I think that's what he's going to talk a bit about. I haven't looked at your presentation, but it's entitled Citizen Science, Empowerment, Inclusiveness, and Equity. So I think that's where you're going. Thanks, Michael. The floor is yours. If you can share your slides or it's on the top. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Petra.
And I will also be very strict with time. 10 minutes.
Yeah, that's maybe the problem. Let's see how fast I can be. I think it should be here. Do you see my PowerPoints?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, good. So I will rush and say, well, first I will say a little bit about how I understand citizen science, and then one of my concerns, having a background in community-based research and science shops, that is really to what extent can citizen science empower civil society. And then the main part of my presentation will be about an ongoing EU-funded project called UCounts, where we at Aalborg University in Copenhagen have a case that deals with citizen science, youth, and circular economy. So I'll be talking about that. And then towards the end, I'll just highlight that, as Petra mentioned, that both Petra and I and two more are coordinating this working group within the European Citizen Science Association, this working group on empowerment, inclusiveness, and equity, and where one of the things we're doing is to get an overview of what are actual experiences with achieving empowerment, inclusiveness, and equity from citizen science. Okay, so I mean, there are so many definitions of what citizen science is, and maybe sometimes citizen science is kind of seen as something with citizens going and collecting water samples or counting birds or something like that. But I think this quite broad definition from the EU is in fact at least covering the understanding that we are working with at the moment, that is, citizen science is defined as a voluntary participation of the public in the scientific process. So that is quite broad. And then EU has a lot of nice words here about that has a great potential for creating developing new knowledge, more inclusive societies, supporting science-society collaboration, and having an active engagement of citizens in research and innovation. But I think this is with the yellow that is the important part. So it's a very broad understanding of citizen science. And then, let's see, then, one of my main concerns since I started getting involved in this formal concept of citizen science like 5, 6, 7 years ago is, well, how can citizens actually be empowered from citizen science? Because in many cases you could understand or see citizen science as citizens collecting data to researchers that then have, of course, more data, maybe better data, and then the researchers get empowered from that. But if we really would like to see, well, how can citizens and civil society as such be empowered through citizen science, then we need also to have an understanding of what is empowerment. And I'm building upon a quite old definition from Paulo Freire, this Brazilian thinker and researcher and activist, that say empowerment is a question about, on the one hand, to understand the social, political, and economic contradictions that you are experiencing, but also developing an ability to act against the oppressing elements of this this reality. So empowerment is actually used in many ways, but the let's say understanding I subscribe to is to see it as a critical paradigm that is linked to social mobilization and collective action. So not this just empowering the individual through more education and so on, so they can be stronger on the labor market. So more, let's say, a collective understanding of empowerment. So this is in contradiction to a more individual understanding of empowerment. There are actually many ways that civil society can participate in citizen science. In the review we are doing in this working group, we are looking into, well, where are citizens actually involved? Are they involved in defining the problem that the project should focus on? Are they involved in the research design, or are they mainly, as often seen, involved in the data collection? Are they involved in the analysis, and are they involved in the application of results? From a equity perspective, you can say, well, how are in the roles of the researchers, let's say the often called research, professional researchers, and the civil society actors in such activities? And there can also be a question about equity between different social groups and activities. Is it more, let's say, the academic citizens that are having a strong role more than, let's say, non-academic citizens? There are different ways that citizens participate in citizen science, and let's say the understanding I mostly are thinking of, that is what we could call civic science or community science, where you have citizens actually engaged in building and applying scientific tools and methods. But there are also other types of citizen science where, for example, citizens go and measure something, take a photo, or maybe take an air sample so they can contribute to the understanding of air pollution, or that they lend their unused power of their computers and so on for analyzing satellite photos, photos from of animals in natural parks, etc. For me, the important thing is that if we are able to work at a local scale, that's probably the area where people are mostly concerned and where they come in the daily life, and they can do observations, and that's also where most people will have a possibility for some community action. But that action does not come just by itself. A good case we have experienced in our working group is a Dutch project where, citizens collected air pollution or air samples, but it was only in the cooperation with the professional researchers that they were able actually to understand the air pollution in different parts of the big city, and understanding what role, for example, the local industry had on the air pollution. So that is, for me, taking the step from contributing to data collection to actually getting empowered from it. So this is kind of the framework for our understanding of citizen science and the potentials, but also the challenges from citizen science. And, here's an example of somebody taking a local sample. But the next part, I will talk about the U-Count project, which is an EU-funded Horizon 2020 project managed by Oslo Metropolitan University, where we have a focus, like in the Finnish project, on youth. So UCount will, as it says here, through co-creative youth citizen social science, so focus on social science and on social problems, with young people between 15 and 29, have them as citizen scientists, and produce new knowledge of positive drivers for social inclusion of youth at risk of exclusion, as well as create innovation and new policies. So the idea is whether and how citizen science can empower vulnerable youth, whether they are refugees or immigrants, or as in our case, citizens in a vulnerable part of Copenhagen. So together with a PhD student of mine, Katrine Linda, we are having a case in the neighborhood of our university called South Harbor. And the social inclusion dimension we are focusing on is the citizenship through circular economy activities. So we are focusing on how can we meet young people in South Harbor and with them work on something that is related to climate and resource consumption. So we have already mapped a number of local actors, and we are also planning to involve some of our university students when they're doing their thesis and so on, doing their internships to work together with young people in the neighborhood. And we'll be using a lot of participatory methods, so you can see it's not just about samples of whatever waste and so on. It's interviews, it's design games, it's living labs, workshops, field studies, participatory action research, and so on and so on. So what we are going to find out during the next 1.5 years, how can local circular economy activities create empowerment and inclusion of the youth in the South Harbor area? And where we precisely will focus, that's what we are at the moment in dialogue with young people about in this neighborhood of our university. It's a part of Aiken. It's a, let's say, an area, very divided area. In one part you have a very old part with small flats, and in the other part you have a new part actually built where there early on was a lot of industrial areas. And this old part is now considered as one of the vulnerable areas in Copenhagen, where almost 20% of young people are receiving some kind of public support, compared to an average of 2 to 3% in average for Copenhagen.
Thank you, Michael. I will have to ask you to summarize your main conclusions, because we need to follow up with them. And I want some time for discussion. It's always the nicest.
Good. So why do we want to focus on circular economy and youth? I would say that we are very much inspired by the youth engagement in the climate debate during the recent 2-3 years, and then hope that we can link that with the interest of young people in the neighborhood. And we have also been looking into some other projects that have been done, for example, in some Finnish high schools, where they find out that young people are actually engaged in circular economy in many different ways, as repairers, upcyclers, makers, learners, and so on. And also that young people are actually quite likely to engage in what we call product life extension. So this idea about that products should last longer, maybe they could, if they don't want to have products anymore, they could sell them to others, or they could maybe share product with others. So these ideas we know has been a possibility in other neighborhoods, and now our challenge is how to get young people in our neighborhood engaged here. So that's actually one of the main challenges, how to find a way of engaging them. But we have our own students that we will involve, and we have also a good connection to a local high school that we hope will enable us to do this. And then here, just maybe we can talk about at the very end of this meeting here, a link to this working group on empowerment, inclusiveness, and equity, where we, among other things, are doing this literature review. And here's a link. Yeah.
Thanks, Michael. Sorry for rushing you through, but I really think discussion is the best part of these seminars. So I would like to open the floor to anyone that wants to openly share a question or write them in the chat, and I will read them. Since we don't have any right now written in the chat, I will start with my own, and then I think maybe some people will ask questions. I see Tina is writing. So thanks everyone. I think the topics were very linked. I see links between the old youth and the U-Count. Probably there is some connection there. And then of course, Daniela came from a different approach, but I think it also resembles your work on air quality, no? So how to use that citizen science approach to empower communities to take action locally. So I will read the question by Tina because I don't want to monopolize. So maybe we start with Tina's question and then I will ask my own. So Tina asks, did any of you have problems with getting research funding for citizen science projects? And I think that's a really nice question, and maybe some of you can answer. If someone of the panelists want to speak, just unmute. I can speak for my own, because like the problem with the research funds is one of the things that came up more saliently in our analysis of this non-weird context, right? And a lot of us are using foundations or other kind of more applied grants, because the funding for citizen science projects, sometimes, especially if the idea is very broad because you want to do it bottom up, it doesn't fit a classical top-down science funding scheme, right? Where you have to already have a research question, you already have to know who is going to participate, you already need to have all these things written down, and then there's very little flexibility to change. But I don't know, Michael, Daniela, you want to add on that?
Well, in terms in relation to whether it's difficult to get funding, well, the funding we have at the moment is not the funding coming from this EU project from Horizon 2020, and that was the second application. So there was one application, both of them coordinated by Oslo Metropolitan University. And the first one was not successful, the second one was. And then on the top of that, of course, we use a number of my, let's say, paid research hours as permanent staff at the university. But it has been possible for us now to have a PhD student employed through that funding and some teaching hours from the university. So that's the main funding we have got. Then we have another project, I could also call that citizen science, where we together repair cafes are looking into their data and developing a calculator for that. There we got the funding from a insurance foundation that funds Danish repair cafes. So for the moment, we haven't had problems, but probably might get in the future, and there might be this challenge about, well, is it research or whatever it is.
Daniela, so you want
okay to... for the CITAQUA project, the budget was too small, so but it was mostly voluntary work, because after the project it was just for the kits and the trips and nothing else. It was not for paying someone to be over there doing research in this is why it is long lasting, the data treatment, because it needs someone to be available for that. So it was financed because it was located in Starreja. There is a OHM, it's an observatoire, parle au milieu, it's a French financement, so it was very localized because it was at Starreja. If I chose another city, it wouldn't be financed. So it was very directed. It's very hard to work with citizen science projects and to have financing. Yeah, there is a lot of options at the European level, but competition is too high. So it's very hard to make local projects with European financement. So. Yeah.
Thanks, Daniela. I see like Pedro has his hands up, if you want to intervene, and then I will ask the second question.
Hello, everyone. My question, I think you'll cross the presentation of Michael and then Daniela, because a few years ago we developed a project named Imprint. I will share here the link of the project, where the participants could share the position of several of points that needed to be some kind of intervention. During the project, we discussed how the information could be mapped. So this, as I understand from the Michael presentation, the engagement of the user is greater if they know the context is a near context, a local, the street, their city, their backyard. And one of the doubts of the Daniela was how the information is mapped on the maps, on open data and privacy issues. How do you think you can manage the information since we have, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, the European, I try to remember the name, the rules for the data that's
GDPR, no?
Yeah. How we can when we worked on Imprint, the rule was not applied, but nowadays is different. So how do you manage that information? Thank you.
Yeah, I should say something. Then in this project, the UConn project, we have been asked by the project coordinator if there are certain rules in our country in terms of protection of personal data, and also when you're working with young people and so on. And in Denmark, we don't have special rules, so we then have to describe how we will protect the personal data, and then that should be approved by the Oslo University. So that is things like that names are not floating around, that minutes that minutes from meetings and interviews and so on are kept in a place where you cannot access without the password and so on. And of course, this informed consent. So we have had to make a long piece of paper. And I would say, if I was a young person that had to sign that piece of paper, I would definitely want to do it when I precisely know what it is about. So that's a little bit the challenge, that you present with a piece of paper that looks very like they are kind of, I don't know, promising to do a lot or promising not to do a lot. So that I think that's one of the challenges. But that, yeah, we have to follow some formal rules, not that dramatic, but when you see them on paper, it looks a little dramatic. I don't know if it was an answer, it was some honest reflections upon how we see it. So we will not present it to them until we are a little sure that, well, what would it actually be about, that what would they engage in?
Thank you, Michael. Daniela, you want to answer quickly?
CITAQUA project was being developed in 2017, so it was not. It was just before the big issue started to spread. But we already had ethical issues, because for the film, for instance, informal, there were consents from the youngest through the teachers. We had that opportunity. She sent to the father and mother, yeah. So it was, there was an informed consent. But for the others, for the other citizens, they were all major adults, so there were no issues concerning that. But it's still, I think the ethical issues must cross over the time. So it was not because of the legislation that came out that we started to think about that. So. Yeah, the data are from that, when there was no legislation during that time, but the ethical issue maintains. The locations of the wells are inside people's houses. How are going to manage even in a publication, in an article, in a paper, how can we manage that? Omitting the, I was concerned about showing here the places of the wells, but it's a general image, so it's not very good. But the reference, the georeference data, the coordinates are more precise, so it's very ethically delicate. I don't know how to surpass that yet.
I think this connects with the question of Tina about the problems with research ethics, and there are several there, but we're running out of time, so it's 47 past 11, so we are already 2 minutes after the time. I see people are leaving. I think there is super nice conversation that should go on, especially related to some ideas in the chat regarding involving schools, how to involve schools. So I think there's a youth school connection here, also a connection regarding empowerment and environmental data. So maybe we should go home with these connections in mind and come back on the 3rd of February to the co-creation workshops and build a nice pilot together. So maybe, Sofia, would you want to wrap it up with some of the information on that?
Maybe if I could just add, I think it'd be nice if you send around names of the presenters and our PowerPoints in PDF, so at least those of us that were here have each other. So I think there were a lot of interesting stuff in all the other presentations.
Yes, great. So we will I will do that if you all agreed that we can share the presentations with the presenters or the participants that came to this webinar. And then as I said, the meeting is going to be recorded, so you will also have it on YouTube later on. So yes, and as Petra said, then I welcome you again to the co-creation workshop that will be will take place on the 3rd of February in the morning. So soon you will have more information on that as well.
Okay.
Great. Thanks a lot, Sofia, for inviting us. And congratulations, because I think this is the last ECIU seminar. So you've done a great job. You've been like pushing through like UAV hacks, COVID on and off. And now it's kind of closing, wrapping up, and everyone will start a new year with more energy, I think.
Yes, exactly. So we will have two more webinars. So this is the last webinar of the year. So we have done 6. And in February, we will have the last 2 webinars with related to other issues as well. So I also welcome you to come again in February, in January, to the last 2 webinars before the co-creation workshop. Yeah.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you so much.
So thanks a lot. And have a nice day and week.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.